Our worship was just awesome this morning, wasn't it? Amen. Hallelujah. Just the love of God. Just so awesome. So tender in the presence of the Lord. Like this morning. Welcome everybody to Reigns of Grace Fellowship. We're going to be taking up this morning's offering. So there's a button on our website at www.reignsofgrace.com. On the right, bottom lower right hand corner, this is a donate. It's a clear cut. It takes all kinds of credit cards. You put your bank account number. It's secured. So you'll get record of your giving as well at the end of the year for your taxes. So if you're giving online or giving here, and you're doing your, what you call, and you fill out that bracket, you spell thousand, thousand. Yeah, you know, I'm just joking. But if God puts it in your heart to do that, do it. Because we're going to take a look at Malachi, if you're Italian, the Italian prophet. Malachi chapter 3 is the last book of the Old Testament. Last book of the Old Testament. Chapter 3. And we all know this, verse 8. Will a man rob God? Yet you're robbing me. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings you have withheld. You are cursed with a curse, for you're robbing me and the whole nation. Bring all your tithes and the tenth into the storehouse. We know that. The tenth, the tithe is to God. It's the tenth of all that you bring in before Uncle Sam takes his cut. Into the storehouse. What storehouse is the place where you're getting fed the word of God, where you attend. It's not to Billy Graham. It's not to Joel Osteen. It's to the place where you attend church. So that there may be food in my house, and test me now on this, says the Lord of hosts, that he will not open the windows of heaven and pour out for you so greatly a blessing until there's no room to receive it. They said, then I will rebuke the devourer, some of the things devour for your sake, and he will not destroy the fruit of your ground, the vine of your field, the grapes, says the Lord of hosts. All nations shall be happy and blessed, for you shall be of the land of delight, says the Lord of hosts. Hallelujah. How many wants to be have blessing and joy? Hallelujah. Glory to God. I want abundance. I want joy and blessing. How many knows it's not a joy to be in lack? And this is one of the things that God says, and not that he withholds things, but you're out. It says right here that if you don't do this principle, you're outside the principles, the principle covering of the Lord, him raining down upon you. Is that giving is the key. And beloved, guess what? You know what? Your pocketbook, my pocketbook is not a problem. See, whatever God tells me to give, I'll give. I don't care if it's the last thing that I have, because I know that you cannot give God, and that you can trust God in everything he tells you to do. And the New Testament said, Paul says, what you purpose in your heart to give, what you purpose in your heart to give. To give. See, finances, we'll round this around home so we could learn about giving, is that our finances, my pocketbook, my bank account, is the easiest thing. It's the easy thing to do is to give. You know, I know the finances will be there. The harder thing is that God not only wants our finances in the bucket that's going to be passed around. God wants your whole life in the bucket. But that bucket that God desires you to be put in, it doesn't have no bottom. So God wants us to jump in the bucket that has no bottom. meaning that it's an endless giving. Hallelujah. You continue to put yourself in to the Lord. Hallelujah. Totally trust Him with your life. That's what He's giving you, time. He's giving you talents and treasures and gifts that to use and do with the body, for the body of Christ and for the kingdom of God. And God just wants you to jump in and be obedient to do what He tells you to do. And the thing is, and this is what God began to tell me and show me, like Jesus walked in this principle. Jesus walked in the open heaven principle. See, many people say, it says, I will, try me now on this, and I will open up the windows of heaven and pour out the blessing so great that you will not be able to room to receive it. In other words, when you walk in the principles of giving, not only your finite time, your treasures, but your time and talent, all of yourself, you walk in an open heaven. An abundance of revelation opens up to you. That God not only flow in you, but He'll flow out of you, because He keeps on pouring down. When the windows are open, when it's raining, it just keeps on coming in, and it doesn't stop. Because God doesn't want only you blessed. God wants everyone around you blessed and changed, transformed in more into His likeness and His image. See, God is a God of abundance. And we got to understand that. We walk in the principles of Jesus. Jesus walked in it, and He lives inside of us. If He could do it, we could do it too. Because the same power that raised Christ from the dead flowed in Him, lives and rules and reigns inside of us. And that same power, that dynamic exousia power, the explosive power, the life-giving, life-changing power lives inside of us. And the thing is, when the Holy Spirit tells you to give something and you step out on obedience and do it like Jesus did, He said, I only do the things I hear the Father say and I see the Father tell me to do. Amen? And God wants us to walk in that. And that's a life of giving. See, Jesus didn't have no lack. Peter come up to him one day and said, hey, you know what? We got to pay our taxes this year. Guess what? I don't know what we're going to do. Peter said, Jesus says, well, if we need to pay our taxes, go down to the lake right down there, and there's going to be a fish flopping around, and I want inside, open up the fish's mouth, and there's going to be enough money in there. Go pay the taxes with it. How's that for a day of fishing? You get paid to go fishing. But to be obedient to do what God tells you to do, you'll begin to walk in an open heaven. That's the giving I'm talking about here. And it's so life transforming. That supernatural power flowing through you. And it just does not stop. It just keeps flowing and flooding and flooding. And that's something that we've been learning about in Ephesians. And we're going to get to there today. So, if you have your envelopes, raise them up high. If you have your tithes or offerings, raise them up high. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord God, this morning your word declared about giving, Father God. I ask you now to bless the gift, Lord God, today in Jesus' name, that it be multiplied. Thank you. It's going to be multiplied for the use of your kingdom. Thank you. Your favor is upon it. Thank you, Lord God, that you're blessing those, Lord God, with an ear to hear and to receive, Lord God, your revelation of what giving is all about, and to not only give what they have, Lord God, in their hands, but they begin to jump in the bucket as well that has no bottom. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Need somebody to take up a user. Glory to God. Hallelujah. If you have your Bible, once again, we're going to turn to Ephesians to chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We're going to go ahead and read the whole chapter here. Beloved friends, because of my love for Jesus, I am now a prisoner for the sake of all of you who are not Jews. I have been made a prisoner so that you will hear the grace gospel that God has entrusted me to share with you in this letter. For this wonderful mystery, the mysterion, which I briefly described, was given to me by divine revelation. Now, what mystery was he talking about? The mystery of the engrafted love of Jesus Christ inside of us that just overwhelms us and floods us like a waterfall. And you know, like a waterfall, the Niagara Falls, it just doesn't stop. The Niagara Falls does not have an off switch or like a shower. You cannot turn off the spigot. It just comes down from Lake Erie and keeps on coming. So if you stand underneath a waterfall, it's going to keep on coming and coming and coming. And that's the way we see the love of God, that mystery, the love of God, which just overfloods us on the inside. And it does not stop there. It fills us to overflowing and keeps on pouring in us, and it comes out of us. And that's the mystery which he's talking about. Hallelujah, Jesus. So that whenever you read it, you will be able to understand my revelation and my insight into the secret mystery of the Messiah. See, he's saying the secret mystery, but it's been revealed that we have a relationship with him, that he loves us so much, and he compels us by his love. He holds us by his love. He arrests us with his love because of what he done to us on the cross and for us on the cross. Many people say, well, that's what he done for me on the cross. Thank God what he done for me on the cross. But they don't know, they don't realize or recognize what he's done to us on the cross. He's totally messed you and I up. He's transformed us, changed our DNA, spiritual DNA. He's changed everything about us. He's changed our heredity. He's changed our seating. He's changed our citizenship. He turned us upside right. See, the world was, humanity, before Christ came, has been ruled by the flesh, has been ruled by their soul. And that happened in the garden before Adam and Eve fell. They were spirit beings and they were ruled themselves by their spirit. So, Pastor, how do you know that? We brought this out several weeks ago about how Adam and Eve, when they walked, they did not have no fear. They didn't, were not ashamed. They walked with God. They were naked before, and they walked with God without no fear, not no shame. But after the fall came, they were led by their fleshly, carnal, soulish nature, their emotions. Oh, I'm afraid. Let's go make fig leaves and hide behind the tree. Adam, where are you at? Why? God didn't know where Adam and Eve were? Of course he did. He was asking a rhetorical question. And the answer was, hey, we hid from you, God, because we were afraid. We were naked. We were ashamed, man. See, they didn't have no more Walmarts. I can't get no cheap fig leaves. There was no, and after it came, God just turned it right side up again. So we're ruled by our spirit, where the Holy Spirit rules and reigns inside of us. And that's an exciting thing. That's the mystery of the Messiah, the inside of the secret mystery of the Messiah. See, back then they had mystery cults, and they claimed to know the way. And they would go into caves and some secret stuff and do some chanting, and nobody knew. Shh. Sort of like the Masons. People might think they know what they do in secret, but they're secretive. They won't tell you anything. As they had them back in, we know the way. Well, what is the way? Can't tell you. It's a secret. Well, how's anybody going to get to the way if they won't tell you? And Paul says, man, this other stuff is garbage. I'm revealing you the true revelation of the Messiah, of Jesus Christ, of God himself. There's never been a generation that has been given the detailed understanding of his glorious and divine mystery until now. He kept it a secret until this generation. God is revealing it only now to his sacred apostles and prophets by his Holy Spirit. Here's the secret he revealed to me. The gospel of grace has made you non-Jewish believers into co-heirs and non-Jewish into co-heirs of his promise of glory through the union with him, and you have now become members of his mystical body, one with the anointed one and one with each other. He's saying you have received this union, impartation, this transformation, and you have been brought as co-heirs. You have been co-joined together, one with Jesus Christ, and you're one with one another. That's why Apostle Paul goes on to say that about being in Corinthians, that you are the body of Christ. You're one. One with him. He's the head. It's like a mystical thing, a spiritual thing, but it's a real thing. That you and I are one with Jesus because of what he done on the cross to us and for us. And we're one with each other. We're united. One with the anointed one and one with each other. The anointed one is Jesus. The Christ. The Lord. I have been made a messenger of his wonderful news by the gift of grace that works through me, even though I am the least significant of all these holy believers. This grace gift was imparted when the manifestation of his power came upon me. Grace alone empowers me so that I can boldly preach this wonderful message to non-Jewish people, sharing with them the unfading, inexhaustible riches of Christ, which are beyond comprehension. It's a grace gift. He's saying, this grace gift was imparted for me when the manifestation of his power came upon me. It says, grace alone empowers me so that I can boldly preach. People say, I don't know, I got to go to class, I got to go to school, I got to go to college, I got to go do this to tell others about Jesus. I can't preach, I can't teach, I can't do it. Doesn't it sound like somebody else you know in the Bible, in the Old Testament, who went to lead the Jewish people out of captivity from Egypt? His name is Moses. I can't speak. I have a speech impediment. Jeremiah. Hey, I can't do this. I'm just a young boy. God says no in Jeremiah chapter 1. You go and you go speak whatever I command you to speak. Other people in the Word of God. I can't do this. Yes, you can. My grace is upon you to do it. Mine empowers you to do it. Because I'm flowing through you. I am flowing through you. Like a waterfall in you and through you that will not stop. And why did he do this? Rather go up to verse 9. God's grace fuels my passion to enlighten every person to this wonderful mystery, which was kept a secret in the heart of God, the creator of all, and was hidden, been hidden from the world until now. And why did he do this? So that every throne and rank of angelic orders in heaven would have unveiled before their eyes God's full and diverse wisdom revealed through his loving plan for the church. This perfectly wise plan was destined from eternal ages and fulfilled completely in the Lord Jesus Christ, so that now we have boldness. Turn to somebody, say boldness. We have boldness through him and free access as kings. You and I have access as kings, not paupers. We have, kings have authority and dominion. Kings have access. Jesus is the King of Kings, and he has full access of all of heaven and all authority and all the universe. And guess what? Because of him, we are co-heirs. We are co-ruling with him, co-reigning with him. And we have dominion and authority because of him. He lives inside of you and I. We gotta grasp that revelation and walk in that. Because that's what Christianity is all about. Many people say, oh, I gotta have faith. I don't have enough faith. It's not your faith in the first place. As we brought out last week, it is a faith of God. It is his faith. Solo fide, as Martin Luther stated on the Wittenberg door. Solo fide, only faith. Only faith, and the faith of God, the faith of God, he imputes unto you. When you say, yes, Jesus, I accept you, he comes in with full reign and authority and inside of you, and the full word of God and grafted inside of you, saying, oh, I'm changed, I'm different. My dear friends, I pray that you will remain strong and not be discouraged or ashamed. That's verse 13. By all that I suffer on behalf of your for your glory, so that when I think of the wisdom of the plan, I kneel humbly in awe before the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the perfect Father of every father and child in heaven and on the earth. And Apostle Paul begins to pray an exciting, awesome prayer for the church, for you and I. He says, my dear friend, I pray that you will remain strong and not be discouraged or ashamed by all that suffering I have glory so on your behalf, for it is for your glory. So when I think of the wisdom of this plan, I humbly kneel before you. I'm sorry, that's verse 15. Lord, the perfect Father of every father in Jesus Christ. And I pray, verse 16, this is the prayer, that he would pour out over you the unlimited riches of the glory and favor until supernatural strength floods your innermost being and his divine might and explosive power. Wow! If that's the only part of the prayer he's praying for us and we're reading about it here, man, that's just a powerful prayer, isn't it? Hallelujah. Yes, amen. God, I'll take it. I'll take some, Lord. I pray that he would pour out over you the unlimited riches of his glory and favor until supernatural strength floods your innermost being with his divine might and explosive power. Till the God of all the universe just that revelation just comes alive and he explodes inside of you. It's like, whoa, overwhelms you. Because that's what it does, it overwhelms you. When the supernatural strength, when that revelation, let me say it again, when that revelation just floods you like a waterfall. It just does not stop of the unriches of his glory, the grace of God, the mercy of God, how much favor and mercy and grace he has poured upon, is pouring upon you. When you just sit underneath, when you just grasp that revelation, he's just pouring it. It's like, oh, the love of God just overwhelms you, and you know and you feel secure, and it strengthens you with supernatural might. They have energy bars. They have energy drinks. There's nothing like the revelation of the energy giver because of the grace and glory and love and mercy of God that just cascades over into you and through you like a flood. Like a flood. And just, it is explosive, changing. If you've ever seen something explode, or imploded, or anything to that degree, it's changed. It's not the same. You blow up something, it's not the same. It's transformed. Even some of its chemical composition has changed. And that's the same explosive power that he's talking about. It is explosive. The energy, the dynamite, explosive, just transforming you into his likeness and his image. Then by constantly using your faith, the life of Christ will be released deep inside of you. And then by constantly using your faith, let me say it again, by constantly using your faith. And what? Whose faith is it? Who gives God's faith inside of you? And it's an action thing. You're working it out. You're working it out. You're working it out. What happens to your muscles if you don't work out? You don't get exercise. They atrophy. You work faith out. You will be empowered to discover that every holy one, what every holy one experiences, the great magnitude of the astonishing love of Christ in all of its dimensions. You will experience the great magnitude of the astonishing love of Christ and all of its dimensions, the height, the depth. You know what? The love of God is so deep. So deep, so high, so wide is the love of Christ. People often say, well, I could experience Christ. I don't need to go to a conference. I need to go anywhere. I don't need to do this. I don't need to do that. And I can see all of Christ from, you know, that I need to see. And that's the thing that I need to see. It's all in that statement. I could stand at Battery Park, which is on the south tip of Manhattan in New York City, and look out over the harbor. And I could look at Ellis Island, and I could look at Liberty Island, and I could look at the Statue of Liberty from far away. And I could see all of the Statue of Liberty, I could see all of Ellis Island, I could see all of Staten Island, I could see all of Governor's Island where the Coast Guard is. But each and every one of those things, those islands, if I go up close to it and go walk on those islands, there's so much more to this that's on those islands that I would never experience if I would stay from far away and say, hey, I've seen it all. See, when you go on Liberty Island and go up to the Statue of Liberty, you never know that there's a museum inside that has all kinds of interesting articles and artifacts. And you would never be able to go up into the crown and look all over. It's like, wow, this is pretty cool. I could see a lot of New York. And you can never tell that what it's made of. And you can never see the inscriptions and find details on the base and all of the wonderful features of Lady Liberty. And it could take you more than one day. It will take you days just to discover that just one island and the Statue of Liberty. And then so on. Then Ellis Island, there's just so much there. You understand what I'm saying here? Is everybody tracking? From far away, I can just stand back and say, yeah, I've seen it, been there, I've seen it all. But I could go and have a great time and take my time and go close to it and experience all of it. And say, wow, this is wonderful. Spend days on Liberty Island, then come back another day and just spend days on Ellis Island and the wonderful stuff to see there. And the closer you get, the more you find out, man, it's totally in depth. It's overwhelming. See, the thing is, in the statement, well, I can see God from right here, I'm fine. It's your attitude. Like here it says, you know what? See, the constant using of your faith as the life of Christ will be released deep inside of you. Reciprocally, the love will become a very source and root of your life, providing you with a secure foundation that grows with growth. Constantly using your faith. How close do you want to get to God? Man, I want to use my faith to get close to God. And so just on the pursuit of His presence, the pursuit of Him. And in the pursuit of Him, I'm listening, I'm hearing what He wants me to do. And the things that He's prepared for me beforehand is placed in my spirit and it comes alive. And then the provision in all of heaven is opened up, just like we've been talking about before, because I'm giving all myself in the pursuit of Him and my giving of myself. I'm jumping in the bucket. I'm jumping in the offering basket that has no bottom. And when I do that, wow, this is supernatural explosiveness just opens up. And it says right here that your faith, the life of Christ, will be released deep inside of you. And the resting place of His love will become the very source and root of your life. The resting place of His love will be deep-seated inside of you, that no matter what comes your way, what storm or anything comes your way, you will be rooted. You can tell a tree that is not deeply rooted, especially when a storm comes and deep winds, strong winds come, and they blow trees over. You know why the trees blow over? Because it doesn't have a deep root system. And that's what it is here. Then you constantly using your faith, the life of Christ will be released deep inside of you. That life, the life of Christ will be released. It's a deep rooted, the solid rock. The resting place of his love will become the very source and root of your life. You will be rooted and grounded. Turn to somebody and say, rooted and grounded. Providing you with a secure foundation that grows and grows. This foundation system just grows and grows. So no matter what storm, no matter what things come in your life, you will be deep rooted, and the root system goes down deep in the solid rock. Christ Jesus is that sure foundation deep inside of you. Verse 18 and 19, then as your spiritual strength increases, you will be empowered to discover that every holy one experiences the great magnitude and of the astonishing love of Christ in all of his dimensions. As this deep-rooted thing, Christ inside of you, you begin to grow. And as you grow, because of it overflows. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This great magnitude of the, you'll begin to experience that empowering and that great magnitude of the astonishing love of Christ. All the stomachs, how deep, intimate, and far-reaching is his love. You'll experience his grace. You won't question about his grace. You won't question about his mercy in your life. You'll know how far-reaching his love is. How enduring and inclusive it is. It goes on forever in your life. How inclusive. You know what? God's love for you is very inclusive. He loves you. He loves me. See, we can get away with it, say, God loves me the most. Because he does. He loves every one of us the most. Oh, come on, somebody. Oh, hallelujah. How deeply intimate and far-reaching is love. How enduring and inclusive is it. Endless love beyond measure. You can't even measure it. Oh, it's endless. It goes on and on. Beyond academic knowledge. Oh, you can't understand it. With it's beyond it. You can read about it. You can study the Greek and the Hebrew and all the rest of the stuff. You can learn about it. You can study in college and everything else. But it goes beyond it. It's beyond academic knowledge. This extravagant love pours into you until you are filled to overflowing with the fullness of God. There it is. There it is. This extravagant love pours into you until you are filled to overflowing with the fullness of God. There it is. There's that waterfall. And that's just only the analogy I am using, the waterfall of standing beneath the waterfall, the flow from the river, the presence of God. whoo, and it doesn't stop, and you don't drown. You can't drown in the love of God that's pouring in you and coming out of you, transforming your life, totally getting wrecked in the Holy Ghost. And transforming and changing other people so they get wrecked in the Holy Spirit too, and God changes their life. Oh, Jesus, never doubt God's mighty power, verse 20, to work in you and accomplish all this. Don't doubt. We can't use this thing up here sometimes. I cannot reason, the voice of reasoning inside of our minds and in our hearts, they're wishy-washy at best. I'm not saying to be the church of the mindless. I'm telling you to be to have this thing transformed by the power of God, and have it wash it every day through the watering of the water of the Word. And we'll read that as in Ephesians chapter 5 some later on in a few weeks. Hallelujah. Never doubt God's mighty power working in you, and accomplishing all this. God's working in you and accomplishing all this. He will achieve infinitely more than your greatest request, your most unbelievable dream, and exceed your wildest imagination. He will outdo them all, for his miraculous power constantly energizes you. Whatever the dreams that you have about your life, he goes above and beyond, just explodes it out and says, whoa, it's far bigger than what I ever imagined, God. You know how you know that something inside of you, a vision or dream of your destiny, is of God? Is that there's no way you could fulfill it in your own power and your own strength. You say, okay, God, it's too big for me in my own fleshly power and my own fleshly mind and strength, but God, nothing is impossible to you. God, you're going to do it. So I'm partnering with you just to flow through me. Just wrecking me, getting me out of the way so that you can move and operate your kingdom fully through me. How's that? He does exceedingly above all that we could ask or think. He will outdo them all, for his miraculous power constantly energizes you. Energizes you. You constantly tired, you constantly feel drained all the time. Get out from the Facebook and get into the faith book. Hallelujah. Get underneath the spot where the glory comes out. You're underneath the waterfall of the glory of God and his love. And he's just blasting you. And you're totally wrecked. And he energizes you because you're totally wrecked. And say, God, here I am. Totally filled and fulfilled. He energizes it. So, Father, this morning, bring this revelation alive. walk underneath the water, stay underneath the waterfall of the glorious downpour of the love of God. To totally jump in the basket that has no bottom. Oh, glory. God, we just ask you, God, we just give ourselves to you. Jesus, let this revelation come alive that we may walk in it. From this moment forward, in Jesus' name, Lord, I pray a blessing on everyone here. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. Shalom. Nothing broken and nothing lacking. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. And everyone said, amen and amen.